worldwide. As of a study which was conducted in 2018, the prevalence of IBS in India varied between 10 to 20%. Briefly, there are four types of the irritable bowel syndrome which are common in community. Based on the Rome 4 criteria, these subtypes are the constipation predominant IBS, diarrhea predominant IBS, mixed IBS, and IBS which is unsubtyped. It is very easy to define. In constipation predominant IBS, there is presence of hard or lumpy stools more than 25% of times. Sometimes the patient has loose or watery stools which is less than 25% of bowel movements. In diarrhea predominant IBS, it is the converse. Loose or watery stools is more than 25%. Hard or lumpy stools is about less than 5% of the bowel movements. In mixed IBS, sometimes it is hard and lumpy and sometimes it is loose and watery. Unsubtyped IBS, there is insufficient abnormality of the stool consistency to meet any of the above three subgroups. So all the four of these types of IBS share a common pathophysiological mechanism, which is the interaction between the gut and brain. We also know that the effect of IBS are varied on the society as well as on the individual. On the society, there are direct, it's like an unnecessary referrals for the consultations, inappropriate investigations. Sometimes there are unnecessary surgeries. There are also a lot of medication costs involved. On individual and family, there is lower quality of life, loss of income due to work absence. There is burden on the partner and the family because of loss of work. On the society, there are indirect components like the cost of the government benefits and the loss of work productivity. So, brief overview of the pathophysiology of IBS. Basically, in a genetically predisposed individual, when there is presence of the stress and psychological comorbidities, there is significant interaction between the brain and gut. However, this is not originating from the brain, it is originating from gut as well. So, what that means is that there is a bidirectional gut-brain axis interaction which is happening in irritable bowel syndrome. This is modified by different external factors. That is basically a gastrointestinal infection, the dietary components, the microbiome and dysbiosis, all of them will interact with the gut to change the enteric nervous system which in turn interacts with the brain, whereas the stress and psychological comorbidities affect the brain which affects the gut. Resultantly, there are two components which result from this interaction. One is the activation of the hypothalamic pituitary axis activation, and there is also activation of autonomic nervous system. I will elaborate this in the next couple of slides. Interaction between these two components will lead to visceral hypersensitivity and altered gastrointestinal motility, leading to immune dysfunction, increased intestinal permeability, or sometimes decreased permeability, resulting in either constipation or diarrhea predominant irritable bowel syndrome. Further elaborating the role of brain-gut axis in IBS. As I said, there is activation of the pituitary hypothalamic axis, which acts on the intestinal target as well as it acts on the adrenal glands by releasing the adrenocorticotropic hormone. The adrenal glands will release cortisol, which are, we all know that they are stress hormones, so they also act on the intestinal nerves. The pituitary hypothalamic axis, when it gets activated, it stimulates the sympathetic nervous system afferents, as well as increase the sensitivity of the sympathetic nervous system afferents. And they act mainly on the three targets on the intestinal wall. One is the enteric nervous system, the muscle layer, and the epithelium. And what will be the effects? There is an increase in motility or a decrease in motility, alteration in the immunity of the gut wall, increase or decrease in permeability, and change in the mucus. Simultaneously, the enteric bacteria, which are affected by the infections, as well as the gut, as well as the diet work we take, they interact on these three components, leading to effects on the brain. So it's a bidirectional interaction between the brain and the gut through all these components. So the principal mechanisms involved are the alteration in the mucus and biofilm production, alteration in the motility, alteration in the intestinal permeability, and finally change in the immune function. So what the final effects are? Production, expression, and turnover of the neurotransmitter, the protection of the intestinal barrier and tight junction intestine changes. There is also modulation of the enteric sensory afferents, bacterial metabolites, leading to immune dysregulation. So for further exploring the mind body connection in the irritable bowel syndrome. We all know that there are significant psychological comorbidities associated with irritable bowel syndrome. Particularly anxiety and depression are quite common among patients with IBS. Most common abnormalities are the dysthymia and double depression. A presence of a major depression, presence of panic disorder is pretty common in patients with irritable bowel syndrome. Central anxiety disorder, this is seen in about 40% of patients. In about 20% of patients, there may be a schizophrenic component which may not be very obvious. It is also seen that following an episode of acute gastroenteritis, the patients who have a prior anxiety, they have been identified that as a risk factor for the subsequent development of the post-infectious IBS. So a person who is genetically predisposed also has a psychiatric comorbidities. When they develop an infection, they have a higher tendency to develop IBS. What are the psychosocial factors linked to the irritable bowel syndrome? There are both sociological factors as well as psychological factors which will increase the risk of irritable bowel syndrome and also change the expression how the irritable bowel syndrome is pursued by the patient. So this is manifested by the illness behavior. We know that some patients tend to seek the medical attention much more commonly than the other patients. The adverse life events will make the person sensitive to any kind of stressors that happen in the life. As well as any kind of intestinal stimulus, the person tends to report more often. Chronic life stress is an important factor. Individual psychological factors like anger, cognitive affective processing, anxiety, depression interact with the sociological factors resulting in manifestations of IBS. As we mentioned, anxiety is one of the most common components that is associated with IBS. IBS patients have a higher prevalence of anxiety disorders than the general population, about 50% versus 25%. Generally, they are in the form of generalized anxiety disorder and panic disorder. The mixed IBS patients are more likely to present more higher scores of anxiety when compared to patients with IBS patient or IBS diarrhea. A strong association is not as a consequence of health-seeking behavior, but truly manifests as an excess presence of symptoms. Additionally, in addition to the anxiety, patients with IBS are also associated with excess, greater severity of agoraphobia, that is fear of the crowded places, anticipatory anxiety, and they also have more panic attacks than seen in the general population. How do we diagnose IBS? There are clinical guidelines which are present to the doctors, but we must understand that these are not a diagnosis of exclusion, but we have to actively make the diagnosis of IBS. Though it is extremely prevalent, sometimes the diagnosis of IBS may not be very straightforward. So what are the pitfalls and what are the features which will suggest IBS, we'll see in the next few slides. So what are the challenges in the diagnosis of IBS? Functional bowel disorders are identified only by symptoms. That means these symptoms can be there in organic bowel disorders also. Presence of non-specificity of these cardinal symptoms, the heterogeneity of patients that present to the physician, the lack of any consistent biological markers, sometimes makes the differentiation between the IBS as well as the inflammatory bowel disease difficult and uncertain. If you take the pooled sensitivity and specificity of these symptoms in IBS, there are three major components which are mostly specific for the IBS. The other components may be sensitive, but there are not many specific. First, we take the cardinal symptom of IBS, that is presence of abdominal pain. It is quite frequent, the sensitivity is about 90%, specificity is only 30%. That means abdominal pain can be there in the organic disorders also. Pain related by defecation has little more specificity. Feeling of incomplete evacuation is less specific. So what are the three main important specific features which will suggest IBS than organic disease? One very important thing is the loose stools at the onset of pain. So if there is a pain at the onset of the loose stools, that is more specific for IBS, about 70%. More frequency of the stools at the onset of pain, again more specific. If the patient reports a visible abdominal distension, though the frequency symptom is only 30%, that has a higher specificity. So these three components may give us a clue that the patient may have IBS than the organic disease. At the onset of pain, if there are loose stools, there are more frequent stools. At the onset of pain, or patient reported visible distension of the abdomen. So what other diseases apart from the IBS can mimic and can be sometimes misdiagnosed as IBS? There are four important diseases. One of which is the infections, common bacterial infections which can get prolonged for sometimes 4 to 6 weeks. The celiac disease, again present in 1 to 2% of the northern Indian population. The inflammatory bowel disease, not very common but gradually increasing because of Western lifestyle. The Helicobacter pylori associated diseases as well as the parasitic infections. So we have to keep in mind these entities and make an accurate diagnosis of IBS for the proper management of the patient. So there have been diagnostic criteria which are laid for the diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome. These are from the Rome 4 meeting. Recurrent abdominal pain for at least 1 day a week or 3 months associated with at least 2 or more of the following criteria. The pain should be related to defecation. The pain should be associated with a change in the frequency of the stool and associated with change in the form or appearance of stool. So any of the two of the components, if they are present in the last 3 months, for 1 day a week. That is the initial diagnostic criteria for irritable bowel syndrome. On the right half, you can see a slide chart which shows the consistency of the stool. It may not be very pleasant for the patient to see, but it's very important component sometimes to differentiate between the irritable bowel syndrome components, whether this is a constipation predominant IBS or a diarrhea predominant IBS. This is called the Bristol stool scale. You can see that from type 1 to 7, there is an increased liquidity of the stool. So first is a pellet-like stool, second is a sausage-like with less. Type 3 is a rough stool, type 4 is a complete sausage-like smooth stool, type 5 is a little bit loose, type 3 you can still see some stool component, type 7 is completely watery stool. So first three types one should diagnose as irritable bowel syndrome, which is constipation predominant. Type 6 and 7 will fall into IBS diarrhea predominant. The mixed one is between 4 and 5. It is also important to note that the Rome 4 criteria have mentioned that there need to be a multidimensional clinical profile, not just the patient symptom. Metaphorical Rome diagnosis you made with the first criteria and based on the stool scale. The additional information should be taken to subclassify the patient into diarrhea, constipation, mixed types. The personal impact of the patient on the disorder on the patient need to be made because each patient perceives the disease different. The physiological abnormalities or presence of biomarkers. And finally, a very important component which is part of the present webinar is the psychosocial influence of the disorder. These must be looked into in patients with IBS. There are different scores for LCVS. They are not commonly used in the clinical practice, but if the patient is very much troubled by the IBS, there can be used to quantify the severity of the IBS. That is functional bowel disorder severity index, IBS symptom severity score, health-related quality of life, hospital anxiety and depression scale, and IBS 36, out of which IBS symptom severity score is a very simple one, which is sometimes used in our clinics. So once we made that there is a provisional diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome based on the criteria and stool form, we'll look at the alarming signs and symptoms of IBS. If there is any presence of new onset of symptoms, is more than 50 years, unintentional weight loss, presence of nocturnal diarrhea, if the patient is anemic or complains of any blood in the stool, if there is any family history of colon cancer, celiac disease or IBD, if any of these components are there, then we should go for advanced diagnostic testing. Additionally, if the IBS patient reports the presence of upper and lower abdominal pain, which is unrelated to the bowel movement or pain radiating outside the abdomen, if the duration of pain is more than 2 years, pain on 6 or more occasions, lasting for more than 30 minutes, we should always look at the other etiologies. So these are the from the American College of Gastroenterology Task Force. They, according to the guidelines, the routine tests like the complete breath count, the biochemistries, thyroid functions, stool, ova and parasite should be done in all patients. And they are enough if the patient has pain delivered by defecation, there is feeling of incomplete evacuation or loose stools at the onset of pain. Whereas the specialized tests like the breath testing to rule out lactose intolerance or breath testing for small intestinal bacterial overgrowth should not be routinely done. They should be done if the patient has any alarm symptoms. If we need to rule out any organic disease, then further tests need to be done like a colonoscopy, which is recommended in patients who are more than 50 years of age. They are not recommended if there are no alarm symptoms. If patients are less than 50 years of age with typical IBS symptoms. Additionally, colonic biopsies can be done if the performing a colonoscopy in an IBS diarrhea patient to look any microscopic colitis. But these should be done only if clinical suspicion is high and the exclusion diet has failed. So features suggestive of IBS, we already discussed pain that is relieved or worsened by the bowel movements, associated bloating, distension, symptoms like migraines, interstitial cystitis, dyspareunia, or presence of lethargy. The presence of other functional GI disorders also supports IBS. If the examination shows any abdominal mass or elevated WBC forms, patient has loss of appetite, there are nocturnal symptoms, fever, or any recent change in symptoms. The patient might have IBS for 20 years, but there is a recent development of blood in the stool. So that should not be taken as IBS, and further tests need to be done. So what we need to exclude if the patient has an IBS-like symptom? One should have a high suspicion if the patient has celiac disease, especially in diarrhea-predominant IBS patients. The cause here is the gluten. So one should perform and IgG endomysial antibody, anti-tissue transmutaminase IgG in the serum. Sometimes biopsies from the duodenal bulb or second portion of the duodenum may be required. The non-celiac gluten sensitivity again related to gluten. So this is a diagnosis of exclusion where person is given a gluten-free diet for a month and then gluten is re-challenged after excluding the celiac disease. I'll be discussing in the treatment part what are code map diets and how they should be excluded. There can also be alpha amylase trypsin inhibitors in the diet, which are non-gluten components in the wheat or cereal. Sometimes they can cause diarrhea, which also we'll discuss in the treatment part. So these need to be combined if you're evaluating a patient of diarrhea predominant IBS. Additionally, patient can have intestinal bacterial overgrowth, which is a result of alteration of the gut microbiota. So there is strong suspicion, then one can perform the glucose hydrogen breath test or lactulose hydrogen breath test, endoscopy and jejunal acid for the cell. The treatment is of probiotics, antibiotics and rifaximin. It is very important to note that some patients with irritable bowel syndrome also have small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. As well as few patients may have a lactose intolerance, which may be primary or secondary. The test to diagnose is a hydrogen breath test. The treatment is low lactose diet or an enzyme replacement therapy. So the Indian Society of Gastroenterology also has recommended the clinical guidelines, wherein they clearly mentioned that a diagnosis of IBS should be based on the identification of positive symptoms and these criteria. Have a survey of alarm features, coupled with a thorough physical examination, and this itself can suffice to exclude organic disease in the majority of patients. A diagnosis based on the positive symptom criteria can not only result in a minimum diagnostic test, but it also helps in early referral in case the patient has a red flag sign. So the first component diagnoses at the community level, and the second component helps to have a prompt referral to note an organic disease. So if the patient has an associated gastrointestinal reflux disease, functional dyspepsia, along with the IBS, it is very important that it is relevant that we need to be aware that the patient could be suffering from more than one condition. Same patient can develop a reflux disease who had an IBS. So this is a final diagnostic algorithm which almost measures everything that I have explained, that the patient with recurrent abdominal pain, bloating or discomfort more than 3 months should have these alarm features as a checklist. If there are alarm features, then it should be referred to the gastroenterologist for the ruling out organic disease. If there are no alarm symptoms, then it is probably IBS. So first we should explain what is IBS to the patient, that is an interaction with the brain-gut axis, and it's a more of a neurological and muscular hyperactivity or hypoactivity coupled with the interaction of the diet. We should treat the primary symptoms. The basic investigations should be done in all patients as a routine, like complete blood count, the presence of the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, the thyroid profile and stool for ovine parasites. These should be done in all IBS patients. If the laboratory results show that the patient is anemic, as leukocytosis, high ESR and CRP, or if there is a fecal ultrasound positive when the stool examination is done, then again we should have a referral to gastroenterologist for prompt investigation. If not, then a repeat visit should be done in 6 weeks time, and we should check for the new symptoms. So this treats almost 75 to 80% of IBS patients at the community level itself. Now I will discuss in the next few slides about the management of IBS. So offering IBS patients a low FODMAP diet, which I'll describe in the next couple of slides, is helpful to reduce the IBS symptoms. So when they ask for the diet regarding the IBS, maybe this can be used in the first instance as the diet which may help in at least 50% of IBS patients. However, not all patients should be offered a gluten-free diet. That should be reserved if there is strong suspicion of celiac disease, and only if celiac disease is confirmed, one should offer a gluten-free diet. Protein is wheat bran supplement should not be given, because sometimes it can aggravate the symptoms. It causes bloating, because wheat bran is a metabolite for the gut bacteria and it can increase the gas production. Whereas psyllium as a supplement can be given to most of the IBS patients to improve, because it is a non-absorbable or non-digestible fiber. The herbal remedies, acupuncture, are unproven. Probiotics and peppermint oil have some role. So the low FODMAP diet is actually recommended as an evidence-based medicine with a low or with a moderate quality of evidence. Probiotics have some evidence, but it is of low quality. The bulking agents have some role. Now coming to the FODMAP diet, which I have been discussing, basically these are what we call as fermentable oligosaccharides, disaccharides, monosaccharides, and polyols. So basically these are the chemicals which are present in certain foods which are commonly used, which can create IBS-like symptoms. So to begin with, this kind of dietary modification can help in about 50% of IBS patients. Broadly, they are categorized to the sauces and food additives, which are quite common these days. With increasing Western lifestyle, many people are using these, and restaurants commonly use these sauce and food additives. Amount of fruits, apple, mango, pear, and watermelon are more likely to cause IBS-like symptoms. So what are we left with? So citrus-related fruits, papaya, guava, these are the other ones which are less likely to cause IBS-like symptoms. From the vegetables, garlic, onions, peas, and beetroots, they should be avoided. Need to be avoided. Among the nuts, almonds and pistachios should be avoided, but one can nuts. So these kind of simple advice can sometimes help in IBS patients to better respond to our medication. So psychological therapies. So every patient diagnosed with IBS should be explained about the importance of self-help and effective management. General lifestyle changes, regular physical activity, dietary modification, symptom-targeted modification should be explained to all patients, which might take about 10 minutes of physician's time, but it really helps the patient in the long-term management. All IBS patients should be offered about the cognitive behavioral therapy to improve IBS symptoms, especially they don't improve with the traditional diet or the medications. It is very important to create awareness to all IBS patients on the chronicity of symptoms, and they should be explained that there may be some expected periodic exacerbations depending on the stress levels. Because it is a stress-sensitive disorder, so the primary management issue results in managing around the stress and stress-induced responses. The proposed algorithm for the management of IBS, so this summarizes what I have discussed in a very brief manner. As we are present, of course, he needs a secondary and tertiary care. All patients should be explained about the education, dietary, and lifestyle interventions. Determine which of the symptoms is predominant. Is it constipation, or is it diarrhea, or is it a mixed irritable IBS specific? Classify these patients. Being constipation predominant IBS, it is mainly a lifestyle modification, the soluble fiber, osmotic laxatives, the stimulants, psychotropics, and anti-anxiety medications. Mixed IBS, again dietary measures, use of antispasmodics, tricyclic antidepressants, antibiotic, probiotic, finally psychotropic agents, and importantly, anti-anxiety areas, because these patients, diarrhea prone, mixed diarrhea patients are more anxiety than the general population. Apart from treating the symptoms of diarrhea and constipation, use of antispasmodics and tricyclic depressants and SSRIs also helps in the symptoms of pain and bloating. If there is no response in the next few months, then the patient should be sent to the psychological therapies, that is cognitive behavioral therapy or a hypnotherapy. So briefly speaking about antispasmodics for IBS, because they act on the intestinal enteric nervous system, plus they have a central effect. So in managing the gut-brain axis, this is an important role for the antidepressants after initial trial of the diet and symptomatic therapy. So generally we give symptomatic and diet therapy for the first 4 to 6 weeks, and patients who don't respond, they should be promptly put on one of these medicines. Commonly used medications are the tricyclic antidepressant, that is amitriptyline, mepramine, desipramine and trimipramine, out of which amitriptyline is commonly used in the dose of 10 to 25 milligrams. The maximum dose generally required doesn't exceed 10 milligrams. As compared to patients with pure psychological disorders, patients with IBS will respond to much lower doses of the antidepressants and tricyclics. So generally 10 to 30 milligram dose is enough. Adverse effects should be kept in mind, like presence of having dry mouth, constipation, difficulty in sleeping, difficulty in urinating, sexual difficulties. So with each visit, patient should be asked for these side effects. However, these side effects can be easily minimized when we start with very low dose, and if we even titrate based on the patient. Of the serotonin reuptake inhibitors, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, paroxetine, citalopram and fluoxetine are present. So commonly used are the paroxetine and citalopram, which are used in the maximum dose of, sorry for this slide, they are generally used in a dose of 50 mg paroxetine or 40 mg of citalopram. The common side effects are the agitation, dizziness, nausea, headache, vivid dreams, sleep disturbance, sexual difficulties or diarrhea. Again, if we start with the low dose and titrate, generally these can be managed. So generally, these antispasmodics and medications should be given through conservative dietary management. Tricyclic antidepressants typically help in patients with diarrhea predominant IBS, insomnia, anorexia or weight loss, whereas SSRIs should be used in patients with IBS, constipation, anxiety or depression. So very important to identify which patients have these pathological components so that these medications can be titrated. Using the wrong medicine for the wrong patient can actually worsen the symptoms. So as I mentioned, we may take up to 8 weeks for the symptom response to appear. If the dietary mediated changes to the or the actual cause of the symptoms, so generally 6 to 8 weeks of non-medication therapy, non-psychological therapy should be tried. And patients who don't respond should be further be given these medications. When started, the onset of the therapeutic benefit of these medications occurs within the first 3 to 4 weeks, but sometimes it may take up to 8 weeks. So common combination that we have used and that helps is the combination of anticholinergic and the many components which are available. The anticholinergic component commonly used is the clindidium bromide, which influences the secretion at the gut and pancreatic levels and also affects the motility of the gut. Present is a chlordiazepoxide, which is a benzodiazepine category. It relieves from the sustained relief from the emotional tension. This is supported by the clinical preservation as well as the extensive clinical use. So in one of the studies, it has been seen that the response to the therapy happens in about 70 to 80% of the patients for 4 to 6 weeks as compared to the placebo, wherein 76% of the patients reported in response and failed response in about 20% of patients. So the combination medicine generally used is also mentioned in the Indian clinical practice guidelines. The use of clinidium at the dose of 10 milligrams, the fixed combination of chlordiazepoxide, which is in a dose of 2.5 to 5. can be given 2 tablets daily, but sometimes the dose can be increased to 3 to 4 times a day if the patient seen that there is an improvement in the patient outlook, the patient attitude, compliance to the medication. It also addresses the key symptoms of anxiety, tension, insomnia, abdominal pain, as well as nausea. The follow-up recommendations as to what is the treatment success for the patient, what actually patient means by the success, what level of improvement is actually acceptable to the patient. You should have strategies to optimize the treatment tolerability. Investigations, so the patient is not looking like IBS, but in 2 to 3 months if there is no response to medications, maybe then he requires further investigation. All patients should be encouraged to report any adverse effects experienced with the therapy as soon as possible. The minimum effective dose should be used to minimize the adverse effects. The last part of the presentation, so in the next few minutes, I mention a case report of a patient that I have seen recently, which I'm sure many of the physicians in the community have seen. So this gentleman is LK, a 35-year-old man who presented with recurrent abdominal pain and uncontrollable urge to push. The bowel movements are very ineffective. He passes through stools every morning and does not feel completion of the stool. He also has other symptoms like loss of appetite and low mood. A year back, he experienced vomiting and blood in the stools, but since then there was no recurrence. At that time, he was hospitalized for the peptic. And investigations showed that there is a relief from the ulcers by repeat endoscopy. However, he continued to have abdominal discomfort and difficulty in passing stools with ineffective evacuation. He also reported that he was sleepless. He was worrying about his condition. There was a big movement in the family. He lost his father about a year ago due to cancer, and he worries that he also developed the cancer. He worries that his family and then financial situation, unless something will happen to the family, what happens to them. So this patient was prescribed citalopram and metazepine by family doctor for a while, which he stopped on its own as he found it was not useful. So he avoids any outside food, prefers to eat simple home meals. He avoids going out with his friends. Because of the anxiety, he changed his job. As the earlier job involved frequent traveling, he was afraid of being stuck in the traffic without a toilet nearby. He's a non-smoker and doesn't drink alcohol. So he presented himself to the hospital thrice in the past 1 year with abdominal pain. His physical examination is repeatedly normal. He was extensively investigated with a laboratory test, endoscopy, as well as radiological investigations. There was no abnormality found. It should be noted that not all patients will require these kind of workups. Since this patient has an ulcer, he was evaluated and all the tests were done. He was prescribed lansoprazole every time without. He was diagnosed based on these symptoms and excluding the organic disease that he has irritable bowel syndrome with underlying anxiety. A fixed dose combination of the clodazepoxide, 5 milligrams, and clinidium were prescribed for a month. He was much better, felt more confident in handling day-to-day activities. He still passes loose stools once in the morning, but the abdominal discomfort has been much reduced. He was, even for 1 or 2 loose stools, should not be targeted for a complete cure. If it is not causing any discomfort and he's not feeling any incomplete evacuation, passing 1 to 3 stools in the morning is all right. And with repeated counseling, he accepted that. Now he's planning a trip with the family, which he was earlier avoiding, and now he sleeps better. So this case snippet indicates how a patient of 5 years need to be evaluated, and adding a antispasmodic and anti-anxiety medication sometimes helps in a long-term control. Patients with IBS often have changes in their gut motility, which is usually driven by the stress by the gut-brain axis, which is a bidirectional event. Visceral hypersensitivity, which is a condition of increased pain sensation in the bowel due to physiological stimuli, is very crucial in the IBS pathogenesis. IBS is a somatic symptom disorder where the brain is involved in manifesting the GI symptoms. Clinidium has an anticholinergic activity and is seen to cause improvement in the clinical and physiological findings in a variety of GI disorders, especially IBS. A combination of clinidium and clodazepoxide is seen to improve both patient outlook and attitudes, and it effectively relieves both the physiological and psychological manifestations of common functional GI disorders like IBS. This is one example of use of the psychotropic and the anti-anxiety medication, but there are other medicines which are being commonly used, like the amitriptyline and the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, that is the procurin. So my message is that all patients need to be looked at the gut-brain axis, their components, and these medications may be judiciously added to the patients after initial trial of the diet and the use of probiotic and antibiotic combinations, which generally being given in most patients for 4 to 6 weeks. Thank you very much for your kind listening.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor. It was a very nice and very good talk. I must say, Dr. Sunil has explained everything simply and in a very in a manner which we are using day-to-day practice and very useful for us in the times to come for IBS. Doctor, can I start the question answer?
Yes, sir.
A small question. Number one, how long we have to continue the medicine in these patients? Because there is one way to start the medicine, then stop after some time, then again start, or it should be continuously used. Number two, anxiety is responsible for IBS or IBS is responsible for anxiety? Both are interrelated with each other, and which should be targeted?
Right. So very relevant question, sir. So taking into the IBS, which is first and which is later, whether it is egg or whether it is chicken. So generally it is the anxiety which is there in the patient. And with another life event like an acute gastroenteritis or acute infection, which will manifest it as an irritable bowel syndrome. So not all patients with anxiety have increased bowel movements. Not all patients with increased bowel movements have anxiety. So generally it is the gut which starts the stimulus, the gut response. So patient who at the onset has an anxiety disorder, suppose the patient is very anxious, has history of previous panic attacks, these patients should be started on anxiolytics in the first consultation itself. Whereas patient doesn't report any anxiety disorder, but over a period of 4 to 6 weeks while on treatment develops these because of his symptoms, then these medicines can be added later.
Thank you, Dr. The house is open. Anybody want to ask any question, please ask.
Dr. Chakravarti sir,
yes,
wonderful
sir.
Delegation on IBS, Dr. Sushil Chauhan here. Sir, when our professor used to teach us about IBS, he used to tell us, once a case of IBS, always a case of IBS. Sir, is that true today also?
Yes, sir. So generally, IBS patients have a physician-seeking behavior. So it is possible that over a period of many years, they develop these symptoms and they have fluctuations and they have repeated episodes of these plates. What is important is that these patients in each episode may not have the same presentation. The patient of IBS, they may suddenly report that he is losing weight. So what I generally do is that even if the patient has come to me 3 times in the past 3 years and he is coming to me 3rd time, then each time I will ask if there are any alarm symptoms. The patient of IBS is not immune to develop cancer or intestinal ulcers, is not immune to develop even inflammatory bowel disease. So if any patient reports any blood in the stool or weight loss or sudden increase in the symptoms, so his IBS symptoms are say stool frequency is generally 3-4 times whenever he has a flare, but this time he has like 10 times the stool. So probably there is an additional component of infection. So those things should be kept in mind. But yes, overall the statement is true that once there is a patient of IBS, generally these symptoms fluctuate over a period of years.
So my second humble question is, many a time we pass on IBS as cases related to anxiety, depression, which Dr. P.K. Gupta also mentioned. At times actually, we are dealing with chronic pancreatic insufficiency.
Yes.
So, I think it's very important to drive home the point for our physician friends. Kindly exclude chronic pancreatic insufficiency as one of the causes of increased bowel frequency before you actually label these people as IBS, as you very pertinently mentioned in your talk, to rule out organic causes. And I think chronic pancreatic insufficiency is one of the very important causes. Your comment on that, sir?
Yes, these patients have, and there have been various studies to say that some of these patients have a little bit of pancreatic enzyme deficiencies, but what we have seen in clinical practice is that mostly they have only perfect. The patients who present, who have a pancreatic insufficiency, invariably have an associated, say, weight loss, or one of the two components that comes in patients with IBS and pancreatic insufficiency overlap is that if they have a sticky or a floating kind of stool. Because the most important component of pancreatic insufficiency is the fat malabsorption. So that causes sticky stools or a floating stool. So patients who complain of these particular quality of the stool, maybe they will get benefited with the use of a pancreatic supplement. But routinely using them in all patients, I would not encourage that. And as I mentioned in one of the slides, if the patient has an upper abdominal pain, so that is one of the patient may have a chronic pancreatitis and resulting in pancreatic insufficiency. So three things I will ask the patient if I need to consider pancreatic supplements. If the patient has any upper abdominal pain, which is severe and disproportionate to the bowel movement. Second, if there is any sticky stool, or third, if there are any floating stools.
Sir, you mentioned weight loss as one of the red flag signs in IBS.
Yes, sir.
But we know from our practice that there is always some weight loss in IBS. It might be related to anxiety. It might also be related to depression. It might be also related to a combination of psychological factors. What kind of a weight loss are you looking at which you actually start having a real red flag sign and you want to investigate this patient in detail?
Again, a very varied point, sir. The presence of weight loss in Indian IBS patients is seen up to 20% of the cases. In fact, this data has been presented last year in one of the international conferences from the AIIMS, that when they conducted a community study, that up to 20% of patients who have no other organic disease, classic IBS, they also have weight loss. And the explanation is that, yes, they have an additional malabsorption, or they have an anxiety or depression overlap. But the crux here is that if any patient reports more than 10% of the body weight loss, so that's where we should be careful that this is probably not simple IBS, but there may be another component. So commonly the weight loss to the tune of 4 to 5 kilos over 6 months to 1 year is present. But anybody has more than 10% of body weight loss in the last 6 months. So these patients will require more extensive investigation. A few kilos of weight loss because of prolonged symptoms. Sometimes patients themselves do a dietary modification that, okay, I need to go to those stools, so I myself has reduced the food intake. So that way I agree that up to 10% of weight loss is quite common in IBS, in our IBS patients especially. So anybody reports more than 10%, then it should be cautious.
Sir,
the
COVID-19 pandemic has taken a very heavy toll on not only the general population as a whole, but also our physician population. They have been overworked in the two massive waves across India. Our daily physician population has been extremely overworked during the fourth wave in April and May. My question is, sir, have you seen increased prevalence or admissions or OPD attendance on account of IBS or GI disorders during the second wave of COVID-19 and post second COVID-19 wave in your practice?
Yes, sir. The effect was not there in the first wave that much, but after the second wave, I personally have seen that the two category of patients who had come in large numbers to the OPD, the inpatient admissions were not that much. So first component is patients who are already having irritable bowel syndrome. With the COVID, the anxiety levels have suddenly gone up. Patients are not able to come out. So they're feeling more isolated. They were feeling more stressed. Many of the people who are healthy also have developed financial problems. And many of the family members have got affected. So that added to the anxiety of the people themselves. So I saw a lot of patients with IBS who are newly presenting as well as patients who had flares. The second component of category of patients are the ones who have recovered from the COVID. So in fact, there is a new entity called as the long COVID syndrome, where patients have a multi-system abnormality starting from cardiac. There are a lot of patients with palpitations, neurological symptoms, unexplained numbness, unexplained weakness of the limbs. Similar to that, there is a long COVID syndrome of the GI manifestation, where patients had diarrhea for 4 to 6 weeks, had non-specific stomach pains, which took almost 1 to 2 months to subside. So I personally saw a major chunk of patients who have had an IBS flare after the second wave.
Sir, you described beautifully the types of IBS, with IBS C, constipation as a predominant factor, IBS D as diarrhea as a predominant factor. Sir, in your own practice, and also relevant to the fact that when we were students in 1982-83 being taught the IBS, we were told that alternating constipation with diarrhea. So is that still the truth, or the truth
yes.
has changed? Is constipation the predominant thing, or diarrhea the predominant thing? And you classified beautifully according to several standards, the Rome criteria, the Bristol criteria. But in practice, a physician, what should he be looking at? What is the predominant symptom, the constipation or diarrhea, or alternating constipation with diarrhea?
Right. So firstly, we should define what patient means by constipation. So I have seen patients who are passing about 4 times the stool, which is unformed. They also say that they are constipated because they feel that there is an incomplete evacuation. So as a physician, I first ask them, what do you mean by the constipation? Are you passing less number of stools, more number of stools, but not completely evacuating? So any patient who describes that, say, for the diagnosis, we take 3 months. So I'll always ask them, in the last 3 months, how many weeks you have constipation, how many weeks you have diarrhea? So the patient says that I had diarrhea for about 10 weeks and constipation for 4 weeks. So then it is a diarrhea predominant IBS. Sometimes patients give that they don't specifically can't classify whether diarrhea is more dominant or a constipation. They say that alternately it hota hai. In fact, we've seen about 1/3 of the patients use a mixed type of IBS, that is called the mixed IBS. But in tertiary practice, I predominantly see patients who have a diarrhea predominant IBS because they have more of an anxiety, they have more tendency to go to tertiary care hospitals and seek investigations, because diarrhea is always much more problematic and much more, I would say, tension creating for the patient. But in the practice, in the community, the mixed type IBS is the most common, like you mentioned. And that's what we have seen in the Indian criteria also, that the mixed type is the most common of IBS. In these patients, generally choosing a treatment may be difficult because of whether to use fiber or whether to use an antispasmodic. So that always becomes a tricky thing. So in that, I always use an insoluble fiber. So instead of using wheat bran, a psyllium-based one works better in these patients.
Sir, I want to ask you, if it is IBS constipation predominant,
right.
And we know that there has been a drug by Abbott for umpteen years called Librax that we've been using, sir.
Right.
And it contains a drug called Librium, I believe.
Right. It has this chlorhydride epoxide that.
Chlorhydride epoxide, and it is an addicting drug itself. It has a potential for addiction. Sir, how long do you use these drugs which has a potential for addiction before you tell them, ये देखो भैया मैंने जो करना था कर अब मैंने कर लिया अब ऐसा करो साइकेट्रिस्ट के पास चले जाओ. So so how often do you use these drugs, and when do you start referring them to a psychiatrist?
So generally, I give these medications for about 4 weeks. Most of the patients start having relief at the end of 3rd and 4th week. One reason is that we start at a very low dose. So in the standard combination, the component of chlorhydride epoxide is only 5 milligrams, whereas the additional dose of chlorhydride epoxide sometimes is up to 60 milligrams in psychiatric disorders. So 2.5 to 5 milligrams, generally, it is not doesn't cause any addictive potential. So if the patient responds within 4 weeks, then we should continue the medicines for another month. and starting from 8 weeks at the end of second month, then you should start tapering. So initially tapering it to once in a day. So I start with twice a day. If the patient responds, after a month I'll increase it to, I'll continue it for 2 months. But after second month I'll make it time, cutting down the morning dose, and then I make it alternate day. At the third month end I'll stop this. And I explain the patient that this might be useful in the next place, but it will be used only after the trial of the after treatment injection if it is causing the flare. The reference to the psychiatrist should always be done if the patient has a major psychiatric disorder, in the sense that despite using the initial lower doses of the anxiolytic, the person still develops a panic attack. Then we should be referring to them. So I would generally treat them for 4 weeks before referring them to psychiatrist.
So my final question is, you mentioned about the element of anxiety, and you also mentioned about the element of depression. You are a consultant in med, and you see lots of these cases, sir, coming through your OBD. And I also know that you are one of the most ethical gastroenterologists in the trade. You never over investigate your patients. When is the time in IBS when you order a colonoscopy or a detailed GI investigation? In your own practice, sir, you told about the guidelines, but can you just tell us briefly about the practical thing in the practice that we should be careful?
Right, so whether it is constipation or a diarrhea predominant IBS, any person who is developing symptoms after the age of 50 years, I always do a colonoscopy in them. Maybe I find only one patient having a tumor, or maybe one patient having a microscopic colitis, but that completely changes the management for them. So any patient coming above 50 years of age with the first onset of irritable bowel syndrome, they should always have the colonoscopy. Any young patient presenting with the blood in the stools, so there I don't go for the colonoscopy, because there's no advantage in doing that. Most of these patients have hemorrhoids and local things. So I do a sigmoidoscopy, because ruling out as colon cancer in young patients, a shorter procedure that is sigmoidoscopy, which is an outpatient procedure, is very easy to do. Patients presenting with abdominal pain which is out of proportion to the bowel movement. Pain abdomen is and diarrhea is happening at the other time. These are the patients who require an ultrasound of the abdomen. Otherwise, in most of my practice, 70% to 75% of patients with presenting with these criteria of IBS, they don't require any investigations, but I always do them the blood form. The complete blood form, the ESR, the stool for the microscopy for the ova and cyst, which are done just generally in 2 days' time, and by 3 days they report the patient can get the result.
Is there any other question?
Yes,
you can.
I want to ask a question, please.
Please ask.
Yes, sir.
Doctor, it can be possible to use when you don't have to use tranquilizer?
No, sir. Actually, not in the tranquilizer dose. So the combination that we use, the fluoride epoxide and the clinidium. Clinidium is an antispasmodic, and fluoride epoxide is an antiandrogenic. So we don't use any tranquilizer dose. For the fluoride epoxide to act for the sleep, the dose will be at least 20 milligrams to 40 milligrams. Whereas for the it to act on the enteric nervous system and on the intestines, the dose will be 0.5 to 10 milligrams. So up to 10, we can use safely, not as a tranquilizer or a sleeping medication, just to control the IBS symptoms. So the patient tranquilizer dose, then we can increase the dose. Antispasmodic, then we use the mebavirine combination. So mebavirine is a longer acting. Sometimes if the pain is acute, then we use dotavirine or protein. Whereas mebavirine is used as a pure antiseptic. or we have another medication which is the pinavirium, pinavirium bromide. So that comes as an LDSAT, that's also the cured antispasmodic. When I use SSRI, that is mainly used for the patients who have a depression or patients who have a constipation predominant anxiety. So their use of the antidepressant and the SSRIs will help, especially the prokaryotic. It works better for the patients who have depression or have a constipation, which is a common combination. What is generally seen in patch is that with anxiety have more of a direct component, patients with depression have more of a constipation problem, because that's how the gut brain axis works.
Does the brain restrict the
food map?
What diet you prescribe to the patient? Because after food map restriction, most of the diet which people are usually taking is gone out. So what diet you prescribe when you restrict food map?
Right, yes sir. So in context, what is mentioned, it's very important that you first you tell them to avoid all kinds of outside sauce and soups. All the sauces, soups, they contain additives. So they will irritate the intestinal mucosa, they act as a chemical piece, and they will definitely create them. Second thing, among the vegetables, you tell them not to take cabbage, beans, and peas. You can allow them to take potato, you can allow them to take brinjal, you can allow them to take the ones which are like ghee, chenda, and tori to begin with. All kind of dals can be used, lentils can be used. Food back diet. Garlic and onion you tell them not to take. Milk products you avoid them. You can take, ask them to take curd, paneer and other things, but pure milk you ask them to restrict to 200 ml per day. Among the fruits you tell them not to take mangoes, pears and the apricots. Whereas they can take banana and citrus group of fruits, they can take any of the things. Papaya, citrus group, as well as banana, they can be taken as part of the non-food map diet. So food map diet is basically apple, mango and pear. Third component is that the patient takes the dry fruit. So you ask them to avoid pista as well as the almonds. Non-food map, you ask them to take walnuts as well as cashews. So some components which are commonly used, if you take out them, then 80% of the food maps are out of the system. So generally, I give trial of these food map diet for the patients who are not responding to the initial medications. Or patients already tried other medications like antibiotics and probiotics, still they are not getting better. They feel a lot of bloating. They feel a lot of gassy symptoms. So in them, this kind of food map diet, giving a trial about 2 to 3 weeks, I've seen that about 50% of patients, they respond to this.
Thank you,
Dr. Sunil, I have just one line question. How do you differentiate between ILBS and incomplete evacuation of bowel? Do you compare both, or they are related to each other? Because when I take breakfast in the morning, I feel like emptying out my bowel and then I feel relaxed.
Sir, this component has not been defined in the international criteria, but in India, this is one of the common symptoms that we all individually have, as well as our patient tells us there's an incomplete evacuation. However, this is not specific for either constipation or diarrhea predominant IBS. So incomplete evacuation is a sensory symptom which is there in all kinds of IBS. Diarrhea predominant, constipation predominant, as well as mixed IBS. So there's no specific that we direct, but if it is more of a diarrhea predominant, then we give antispasmodics. Sometimes that works for the incomplete evacuation. But if we control the stool frequency, most of the times the incomplete evacuation goes off. But I agree that it is not in any of the criteria of that IBS. It is just a symptom which is associated with the IBS.
Okay.
Yes,
Dr. Sunil, can I ask a question?
Yeah, sir.
When do you use Rifaximin? Is it only in IBS diarrhea or IBS constipation also there is a role of Rifaximin?
Yes sir, there is a role of Rifaximin even in constipation predominant IBS, because some of these patients have a bacterial overgrowth. So there are what we call a methanogenic bacteria, so they produce methane from the gut. And methane is a intestinal depressant. Unlike a lot of other gases, methane reduces or inhibits the enteric nervous system. So it causes more of a constipation. So patient may have some methanogenic bacteria in the gut. In constipation predominant IBS, if they are not responding to traditional fiber supplements and the laxatives. Always give them a 2-week course of rifaximin.
Without testing for SIBO?
No, sir. So initial component, I never test them anybody for the SIBO because at least 50% of patients respond. So in non-responders, then they require a longer course of treatment, then maybe I test for the SIBO. Or patients who has earlier taken and then responded again coming with the symptoms. So there I recheck to make sure that I visit for long term.
And what dose you would give in SIBO?
Generally give 550 mg 3 times a day, that's the recommended dose. I have seen that even twice a day most patients respond. But I begin with 550 3 times, and after week, 2 weeks when the patient responds, I reduce it to 550 twice. I generally continue it for a month in patients who are responders.
Right. Thank you.
Dr. Gupta, can I ask a question?
Please ask.
Firstly, compliment to Dr. Sunil for a lovely talk. For a very common disorder, very well explained everything. Myself, one question, we treat a lot of diabetic patients, they have gastroparesis. And they all have these kind of symptoms, bloating is there, discomfort is there, sometimes hospital. So how do you tackle that? Diabetic gastroparesis.
Right, so if they have these kind of a bloating which is unrelated to the meat, any unrelated to the bowel movement, sorry. So any patient who has symptoms related to the bowel movement, it is part of the acne period. Like patient says, I feel bloated, I go to the washroom and I feel normal. This is part of the IBS. As you said, some of these patients will have bloating related to the upper stomach, which is a part of the functional dyspepsia like gastroparesis. So we have to differentiate whether it is related to the IBS. Then you don't need any specific therapy for the bloating and distension. If it is unrelated to the IBS symptom, then the patient is having a functional dyspepsia.
Mostly they have functional upper GI, the upper abdominal. Right, so all of them initially they have a trial of the pantoprazole or finlandia or anything else GI. Right, so all of them initially they have a trial of the pantoprazole to begin with, but these patients require additional gastric muscle relaxant, so I usually use them either on the itoprazole or one of the new component that is the acetamide.
So itoprazole generally is a dose of 150 mg once a day in the morning. Works for the most of the diabetic patients. So if they are not resting and they complain of visible bloating, sometimes patients say that my stomach actually visibly bloats up.
Itoprazole can be comprised with pantoprazole also.
Yes, sir. You can give a combination of that, the itoprazole and the pantoprazole. And if the patient initially they have a symptom of a visible bloating, in these patients I always give a trial of the rifaximin, because these patients have an additional component of the bacterial overgrowth.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Sunil Chakravarty, you have been very good and very nice, and we are very thankful to you for delivering this good lecture. And I'm